What's the matter, Mr. Gardner? The messenger carrying the payroll of the mine was held up and killed a few hours ago.
He was?
Things is getting worse and worse around here.
It was Charlie Roth they killed. And I demand that you bring those murdering thieves to justice.
Who were they? Did you find any clues?
They never left a thing. Well, they even took poor Charlie's watch.
Well, I'll do the best I can, Mr. Gardner.
Your best hasn't been very good so far.
Now, now, Mr. Gardner. You mustn't be too hard on the marshal. He's only been holding office for a month.
Maybe he needs help. Maybe we ought to organize a vigilantes committee.
Now, I'm just as much for law and order as any of you. But I don't think it's right to take the law in our own hands.
I think Ma's right.
Maybe so. But I'm going to ask the United States Marshal in Santa Fe for help.
Maybe it's best if I would resign, Ma.
No such thing. Sooner or later, the day of reckoning will come. The wicked will be punished. Now, son, I worked hard to help you get elected. Now, I don't want to hear you say again that you give up. Because if you do, I'll take you over my knee and spank you. Now, you stay in office, son.
Howdy, Sam. How's your rheumatism today?
It's a mite better, thank you.
That's right. Always look on the bright side of things, and they'll turn out all right.
My wife's mighty grateful for the basket of groceries you sent over, Miss Burton.
No thanks needed, Sam. We must always share our blessings with others.
You always do, Mum.
Nonsense, nonsense.
Who is it?
It's me.
How much is it?
$3,825.50.
Right to the nickel.
How did you know how much there should be in the payroll?
It's my business to know. Where'd this come from?
You know, Tex, he hates to leave anything behind. Ma, do you suppose that the marshal at Santa Fe will send a man down here if they ask him to?
Well, we'll be able to handle that if they do. The smarter folks are, the easier they are to fool.
Gardner here?
Yeah. Mr. Gardner.
How do you do, Mr. Gardner?
Well, what is it?
Well, well, Hoppy. Glad to see you.
Get down. Get down. Say, what are you doing in that outfit?
Ah, come on in now. This is one of Marshal Thorpe's ideas.
Say, are you back on the old job again?
Sure.
I'm sure glad they sent you.
So am I, if I can be of any help. Say, John, what about this messenger of yours that was killed?
That was Charlie Roth, my best friend.
Oh, that's too bad. You got any suspicion?
Suspecting is one thing and proving's another.
No ideas, huh?
Not a thing.
Looks like it's gonna be a tough one. Well, I'll run on into town, keep my eyes open. If you see me in there, just don't recognize me.
I certainly wish you a lot of luck, Cassidy. Because I've got $15,000 in silver bullion. Get away that I'm afraid the ship for fear it'll be hijacked.
You got it guarded?
Keep a man here all the time.
Good. Well, I'll see what I can stir up.
And I'll do anything I can to help you.
Fine.
Yonder in the swelling rays of the sun lies the fair town of Del Oro, to whose esteemed and suffering citizens we are about to bring blessed relief from all of their aches and their pains. Zerbo, the greatest combination of roots, herbs, barks, and bitters that has ever been known to mankind.
Save the spiel for the customers tonight, Pop. I'm getting sick and tired of this kind of life, bouncing from one hick town to another, living from hand to mouth. We haven't even got a show without a strong man and a mind reader.
Yes, well, anyway, I won't have to listen to their petty arguments about wages.
If you'd have stayed out of that poker game in Santa Fe, you'd have had enough money to pay them.
Oh, yes, well, that was unfortunate. I can't understand that. My opponents were unusually lucky. My own cards. I'll have to change the markings on those things.
Pop, sometimes I don't know how I put up with you. Well, I suppose there's no use crying over spilled milk.
Of course not, dear. You must have faith in your luck, Paula. From now on, everything that happens to us will be only for the best.
couldn't possibly be our will. Maybe you better go down and take a look.
I expect I better.
Well, come on, Pop. Let's get after it. What are you trying to do, Axel? Wish it up?
You know, I read a book on hypnotism once, where you can make things float.
Maybe you need a little more practice. Dad, lend him a hand there. He can't do it by himself.
Oh, now, Paula, you know how this altitude affects my heart.
An accident?
No, that's the way we always stop.
Oh, a new idea, huh?
Yeah.
Can I help you?
Well, somebody has to.
I think if you put the other box under there, you'll get more leverage.
That's a good idea, brother.
Here, I'll do that while you get the wheel.
You reckon I ought to put that back on?
Well, it might be a good idea.
Oh.
It's all right. He's harmless.
This won't disturb you, will it?
No. Oh, that's all.
I've been waiting a long time to meet up with one of those medicine show guys again.
Well, what's the grudge, Tex?
Plenty. A year ago, one of them sold me some dandruff remover.
Did it remove it?
Yeah. Everything.
Where do you think you're going?
Well, sir, now, brother, I'm certainly glad that you asked me that. I'll tell you. You see, the fair town of Del Oro has long awaited the boon of Zerbo Indian Remedies, a guaranteed cure-all for people who suffer from corns, calluses, bunions.
Does it remove dandruff, too?
Well, now, brother, I'll tell you. Zerbo is not a specific in the treatment of dandruff, but in 9 cases out of 10, I have known of it to remove everything.
Get your contraption turned around and headed the other way. You ain't going into Del Oro.
You don't happen to be the town marshal, do you?
What if I'm not?
He's usually the one who says whether or not we'll do business in a place.
Yeah? Well, in this case, I'm doing the same.
In this case, nobody's listening.
I wouldn't cross him up, miss.
What are you sticking your horn in for?
Oh, I just don't like to have any trouble.
Now, keep out of this or you're liable to get your ears slapped down.
Are you going to let that big bluff get away with that?
I'm not looking for any run-ins with anybody.
Now you're showing good sense, fella. And remember, stay out of town.
Oh, wait a minute. With the compliments of the house, sir, it's Dr. Tate's famous pain alleviator. Good for a pain in the neck.
That's one on you, Tex. Well, that'll be the last one on me from this outfit.
Say, Paula, you shouldn't have antagonized him like that.
I know it, Dad, but what are we going to do?
Say, I might be able to help you. Maybe I could make myself useful around an outfit like this.
Hey, the chump may have some money. We'd be very happy to have you with us. That is, of course, if you have the necessary qualifications. Now, just exactly what is your profession?
Well, I've been a little of everything in my travels. A cowboy. I've done blacksmithing, horse doctoring. I can mend saddles and bridles, fix machinery, carpenter a bit. I've cut a little bit of hair. I can even pull a tooth if I have to. And if I was persuaded a little bit, I might be able to bake a cake.
You could. My friend, you have brought your talents to the right market when you brought them to Dr. Rufus Tate. Do you realize that you're standing on the verge of one of the greatest opportunities that a man ever had? Do you know that in my possession of the secret formula for Zerbo Indian Remedies, I have what is practically a gold mine? Now listen, brother, if you're willing to join us, you could make a fortune overnight.
But, Dad, this man doesn't know anything about show business.
But we could teach him, dear. We could open the show with him playing a guitar.
Me play a guitar?
Yes. Well, you said that you used to be a cowboy.
Yeah.
Well, all cowboys nowadays play guitars.
This is one cowboy that never played a guitar and never will.
Oh, well, that doesn't make any difference. Say, we could let you take Marvello's place, work you into the mind-reading act. Mm-hmm. Do you realize, my friend, that this is a golden opportunity for you? That for $500, you can buy a quarter interest in this business?
$500?
Yes, sir.
I can only spare 40.
Well, that's better than nothing. I mean to say that that'll be a deposit, and then we take the rest out of your share of the profit.
Now, Dad, I...
That's all right, miss. Yeah. You got yourself a partner, Doctor.
Yeah.
Well, we better get this wheel on.
You've got the $40 on you, of course. See?
Oh, yes.
Yes. Yes.
There you are. I think you'll find that right.
Yes. Thank you.
I'll go over to the marshal's office, see about getting us a permit.
We'll pull into that vacant lot up there.
All right.
Looks like your big talk didn't scare those medicine folks none, Tex.
Yeah. They're liable to be sorry for it before the night's over.
You act a little nervous.
This town's got me.
Yeah? Well, you're the town marshal, aren't you?
Not anymore, mister. Just when I was about to get the town under control, well, folks sent for a government man to come take my place.
Oh. Well, where can I find him?
I don't know. Don't even know who he is.
That's bad. That puts me in a tough spot. I wanted to get a permit to open the medicine show here for a week.
Why, go ahead and open up. Nobody will stop you.
No? Fella standing over there said he'd stop me. The one with the dark hat.
Oh, him. That's Tex Barnes.
What's he do?
Well, he runs a ranch out here on the border road. Say he's a good hombre to stay away from.
Being a town marshal, you ought to put a man like that in jail.
Mister, I had him there long ago. But you can't put a man in jail because you think he's doing things. You gotta have proof.
Yeah, something like that, too. Well, thanks for the warning, Marshal. Now, stay away from him. See you later.
So long.
Say, I want you to go over to the horse trough and get a bucket of water. I want to mix up another batch of Zerbo.
Ah, me.
Well, hurry up.
Everything's all set, Miss Paula.
Oh, thanks.
What is this Zerbo your father sells?
Oh, a little water, a little tea for coloring, and something to make it taste bitter.
Is that what he sells people that are sick?
It can't do any harm. And you'd be surprised at the amount of people it helps.
Oh, I suppose so. A lot of people just think they're sick anyhow.
Look, this is what you're going to wear tonight.
Me?
Uh-huh. You're going to be Marvello in the mind-reading act. I can teach you the code in half an hour.
The code?
Yes. For instance, if I say, what is this? That means it's a gold watch. And if I say, this is what? That means it's a silver watch. And if I say, and this is what? That means it's a watch with a closed case. You see how simple it is?
Oh, yeah, very simple. You can teach me the rest of the code when I put up my horse.
So help me, I'm going to ask the chief
to come down here to the front of the platform and render one of his tribal dances for you. You mind, Chief? Thank you. Friends and neighbors, to talk to you about your health. You don't know how much we appreciate, neighbors, the reception that you have accorded us here tonight. We have always looked forward to playing this beautiful little city of
Del Oro.
Yeah, Del Oro. We've always looked forward to coming here, and tonight we've satisfied that wish. Now, my friends, so many of you, those of you out there in that audience tonight that are sick in mind and in body, I have got a message for you, my friends. I'm not here to sell you anything. I'm here to advertise. Friends, the minute you folks out there get sick or something, you go running off to some doctor. I have never been sick, fatally sick, a day in my life. And I eat everything. I don't eat codfish because I don't like it. But anyway, I'm glad I don't like codfish, because if I liked it, I'd eat it. And I hate this stuff. You see what I mean, brother? I want to read you a letter I got from this fella here. I get thousands of these letters every day, my friends, from people all over the country that come to me for succor, at least for succor. This fella here, I'll read you this letter. Here it is right here. It says, unless you leave town immediately. That's not it. That's a personal letter. I sold 500 cases of Zerbo remedies, my friends, to one drugstore in the last town on the strength of this letter here. All right, I can show you the canceled order. You come back after I'm through here, and I'll show you the canceled order. Says here, oh, this is not it. This is from a woman. I treated this woman's husband, my friend. This man was threatened with paralysis. He was about to become paralyzed. Don't laugh, brother. It's an awful thing to be paralyzed. You feel so rotten the next morning. Well, anyway, I treated this woman. Listen to what she has to say. She says, for years, my complexion has been all blotchy and broken out in places. But she says, after taking one bottle of Zerbo Indian remedies, and those are those bottles right over there, my friends. She says, after taking one bottle of Zerbo Indian remedies, I now have a complexion like a peach, she says. Fuzz and all. Now, friends, I don't care what's wrong. Wait a minute, I want to read you. Oh, here's this letter I was looking for. This man here, he says, for years, he says, I've suffered from insomnia. I've had a bad case of insomnia, but he says, after taking only one bottle, you notice they all say just one bottle, neighbors? Just one bottle. He says, after taking one bottle of Zerbo Indian remedies, my insomnia is completely cured. Isn't that nice? He says, I lay awake nights thinking of how I used to suffer from it. Now, friends, just a minute, neighbors, don't go away, because we've got a lot more entertainment here tonight. Friends, it is my privilege to introduce to you one of the most mystifying, one of the most astounding acts that has ever played any theater, any place.
Friends, you know, I got a feeling I'm not going to like this. That mystic
There's nothing to worry about.
My friends, who has fooled him from Singapore to Paducah, Illinois. I don't know what state Singapore is in.
Friends, don't forget the color.
Where is it?
To introduce that mental marvel, Marvello.
Oh, I'd rather face a herd of wild buffalo and go out.
Go on, it's all right, Bill.
gentlemen, Mademoiselle Paula, whom you've seen early in the evening, will now pass through you. And any objects that you will give her will be named by the mental mystic Marvello. Through thought transmission, my friends, alone. Are you ready, Marvello?
What have I got to get ready?
Are you ready, Mademoiselle Paula?
Yes, Doctor. Now, who'll give me an article, please? Oh, thank you. What is this, Swami?
Gold watch, gold chain.
That's right, Swami. Thank you. Now, who has something else?
Well, Tex, I see you decided to let the medicine show work in town after all.
I don't get it.
Tex got all head up on the road today when the girl in the show told him where to head in. And she made it stick, too.
You think that's funny, huh? Well, follow me and I'll give you a real laugh.
Oh, may I? What am I touching, Swami?
Lock it.
It's wonderful, Swami. Do you mind?
Not at all.
This is what, Swami?
Spectacles for eyes.
Correct!
Pretty good, isn't it? Full
of stuff. And this?
Here.
Tell me what this is, Swami. Oh, come, Swami. Tell me what this is.
Pencil.
Correct, Swami. Absolutely correct. Now, does anybody have anything else? Anyone else?
Hello.
Hello. Oh, do you have something you'd like the Swami to call?
I told you what to expect if you came into town.
Well, it's Mr. Payne in the neck himself. What is this, Swami?
I'll give you just 1 minute to get that contraption started out of town.
Wait a minute. Where I come from, men don't talk to women like that.
If you don't like it, you know what you can do.
I sure do.
Who are you pushing?
You all right, ma'am?
Oh, it's just a mite upset.
Can I drive you home?
Oh, no, thank you. I live just across the street.
Oh, well, I'll help you over there.
Thank you. Oh. You're with the medicine show that came in today, aren't you?
Yes, I am.
Well, I'm Ma Burton. What's your name?
Cassidy, Bill Cassidy.
Oh. Oh, what started all the trouble, Mr. Cassidy?
Oh, a fellow by the name of Barnes decided he wasn't going to let us run.
Oh, he's a very bad character.
Really?
Yes.
From what I've seen around this town tonight, there are plenty of bad characters.
Oh, there are, in spite of all that we can do to keep our little town a decent place to live in.
Are you hurt, Ma?
Well, I'll be all right as soon as I get a strong cup of tea.
We're all very grateful for what you've done for Ma Burton, mister.
Thanks.
Yes, Mr. Cassidy, this is Mr. Blake, one of our boarders. He's a mining engineer.
Howdy.
How do you do?
Oh, your outfit's quite upset, isn't it, Mr. Cassidy?
Yes, kind of, but we can get that fixed up in a couple of days.
Well, you're welcome, you know, to put up at my place until you can get settled around.
Oh, well, we wouldn't want to put you out.
Oh, you'd make me feel very unhappy if you said no.
Well, this your place here?
Yes, right over there.
Well, I guess so. Just as soon as we get things fixed up the wagon.
Well, right there. I'll have a nice little snack waiting for you.
Fine.
Tex's trying to attract all the attention he can to himself. You tell him to walk easy, or he's got me to deal with.
I will. But, Ma, do you think it's smart bringing all these people in here? The least little slip...
There won't be any slips. I want to find out more about this man, Cassidy. He's not just a tenderfoot medicine show man.
He's all right. He's coming, too.
Oh, that's fine. Say, that was mighty nice of you, young fella, to throw in with us strangers.
Forget it, mister. I like to fight now and then.
Paula, what are you trying to do? Kill me? You know that I can't drink that stuff. I've got a weak stomach.
Well, I thought that was...
Well, it's just that I'm allergic to it. That's all. It's anybody else's.
Have some more tea, Miss Paula?
No, thank you. I think I'll turn in if you don't mind.
That's right. Have a good rest, dear.
Yeah, well, I think I'll turn in, too. I'll see you in the morning, Bill.
All right, Doc. Will you excuse me, please?
Oh, won't you sit down and talk to me while I have another cup of tea?
Well, All right.
You know, Mr. Cassidy, it's a funny thing. I keep thinking that I've seen you somewhere before.
That is funny. I've never been in this part of the country before.
Is that so? Been with the medicine show long?
Not very.
How'd you happen to join up with a thing like that?
Well, a man has to eat.
Oh, a man like you doesn't have to join up with a thing like that in order to eat. There's plenty of other ways.
Maybe I like that kind of life.
It's a funny thing, Mr. Cassidy. I've been around men folks all my life. And I've learned to know them. These old eyes, they can see a lot of things that other folks has missed. But a man like you doesn't have to join up with a medicine show. You have to give me a better excuse than that.
And that's the best excuse I can think of.
Well, it's my guess that you're covering yourself, hiding from the law. Or maybe a part of it. Oh, well, whatever it is, I'm grateful to you. And you needn't worry about my saying anything to anybody.
The warden at the Kansas prison would certainly get a big laugh out of hearing that Bill Cassidy, ex-convict number 4261, was any part of the law. I just got out 3 months ago after serving 6 years.
Well, Bill, I don't hold that against you. Anybody's liable to make a mistake.
Yeah, but my mistake was getting caught. That won't happen again. I've learned a lot of things since then.
Oh, now, Bill, you mustn't talk like that. If you make up your mind that you want to go straight, you can.
And don't you worry about me, Ma. Just don't mention anything I've said.
You can trust me, son.
That's fine. I'll go watch the wagon so Axel can come over and have a bite to eat.
Well, I'll heat up something for him right away. Did you hear?
Every word, Ma.
You know, for a fella as smart as he is, he opened up awful quick.
Well, it's no wonder. The way you were mothering him, anybody would have opened up.
I'm not so sure of that. Tell Flint to see him tomorrow and have a talk with him. See what he can find out.
Hey, are you sure you're all right?
Oh, yeah.
You better run over to the boarding house and get yourself a bite to eat. I'll be over in a minute. First house up the street.
Say, you know, if you kind of teach me how to fight like you do, I'll teach you how to hypnotize.
Run on. What are you doing down here? I thought I told you to stay at the ranch.
Well, how do you think that free-for-all would come out if I had it?
There wouldn't have been any free-for-all. You know I ought to break your neck. You need to gum things up for me.
Well, as long as I didn't, Hoppy, what's my part of the job?
Well, so long as you're here, I might use you at that. If you'll just for once do what I tell you.
Oh, you can depend on me.
All right. Now, I want you to keep your eyes open and don't let anybody get back of you. For a couple of days, you're going to be the marshal they sent down here from Santa Fe.
What's it all about?
Well, I'd rather have certain folks around here think that you were the marshal than to go around thinking I might be.
You mean you got a lead?
No, not yet. But I've got a hunch that before long, a certain man by the name of Blake is going to want to talk with Bill Cassidy, ex-convict number 4261.
Convict?
That's me.
Axel, we better get this stuff cleaned up while the wagon's getting fixed.
Good morning, miss.
Good morning. I should think after last night you'd have had enough of this town.
Well, an officer of the law ain't allowed to pick his spots. Besides, I guess I proved I can handle myself. Somebody starts trouble with me, I got a quick way of stopping him.
About all you stopped last night was a lot of lefts and rights.
Oh, I don't know. Say, you're gonna have a lot of spare time here on your hands with your wagon being fixed. How about going for a ride with him this afternoon? It's a mighty pretty country around here.
Nope, I'm going to be busy.
Well, how about tomorrow?
I'll still be busy. Come on, Axel.
Well, how about the next day?
Does a house have to fall on you to make you understand?
Oh, I get it. You mean you don't want to go riding with me? I'll bet if my name was Bill Cassidy and I was working on the show, you wouldn't be too busy to go out with me.
Did you figure that out all by yourself?
You belong to?
Man, this ain't no lodge. This is hypnotism. I'm practicing it. Sleep. Sleep.
You mean you can do like this and it puts people to sleep?
Sure.
And all you have to say is sleep, sleep, sleep.
Morning, Ma.
Morning. Been for a ride this morning, Bill?
No, just over taking care of my horse.
Oh, Bill.
Oh, hello.
The blacksmith tells me he'll have the wagon ready for us by Sunday morning.
Well, that's fine. Then we can open Sunday night, huh?
Yes. Mrs. Burton, do you mind if I use your tub so I can clean up some of this stuff?
Oh, you're welcome, honey. And if you got any mending, why, I'd like to help you.
You're the sweetest thing on earth, Ma.
I always believe that give and ye shall receive.
Well, I think I'll leave you women folks to your knitting.
Where are you going, Bill?
I think I'll go to the saloon. I feel a poker game coming on.
Oh, give my regards to Dad.
Is he over there?
Well, if there's a poker game going on and Dad's got a dollar, that's where you'll find him.
See you later.
Cassidy's a fine man, isn't he, Miss Paula?
Uh-huh.
Have you known him long?
Oh, yes. Since yesterday.
Where'd you meet him?
Had a breakdown on the road, and he came along and offered to help.
Oh, then you don't know very much about him, do you?
No more than you do, Ma. But whatever he is, he's all right.
Kind of like him, don't you, Miss Paula?
Uh-huh. Kind of.
Hello, Cassidy.
Hi, Flint.
I'd like to talk to you in my office.
All right.
Sit down. Let's get to the point.
Well, you're doing the talking.
A man like you, Mr. Bill Cassidy, especially one who served time in the Kansas State Pen, didn't come down here just for the climate.
I thought I covered myself pretty well. How'd you find out?
A couple of people I know served time in that pen at the same time you were there. I was pretty sure I recognized you.
Well, what's your next move?
I'm not making any move unless you make a wrong one.
Oh, stop your bluffing, Marl. You didn't ask me in here just to give me a little brotherly advice. You and your outfit's afraid I'm going to cut in on some of your business.
Are you trying to accuse me?
Take it easy. You know, you and me are in about the same kind of business.
Listen, don't try to pull any jobs around here.
Maybe we can get together. You supply the men and I'll supply the brains.
We've got all the brains we need.
Yeah?
Not enough to get that $15,000 in silver bullion at the Gardner Mine.
You know how to get it?
I'll tell you that when you tell me you're in on the deal.
Well, I'll think it over.
Fine. You know where to find me if you want me. See you later.
Give me a drink, Dan. I'll be back in a half hour.
All right.
Say, Mr. Bartender, you know, something tells me that if I can get back into that game, I can break it. Now, if you just lend me $5, I'd split my winnings with you.
Mm-hmm. I'll stake you to $5, but you got to give me your right eye for security.
Now look here. Wouldn't my watch do just as well?
Excuse me. Say, we might as well keep this watch in the family, Doc. I got $5.
Oh, you have?
Sure.
I'm gonna get that coyote. Be ready to back me up. So you're the marshal they sent from Santa Fe, huh?
Yeah. I guess that little lesson you got last night didn't do you very much good.
We don't stand for outsiders buttoning around here.
I think this entitles me to butt in anywhere I think I'm needed.
You better hide that piece of tin, Sonny, or somebody's liable to shove it down your throat.
Well, it won't be you. I think I'd better lock you up for a while until you learn a little respect for the law.
Yeah, that's what you...
Don't anybody move. Better study up on your law books, Marshal. You can't arrest a man unless you got a charge against him. Now go on while you're all in one piece.
I'll remember you, mister.
You had no call button in. Looks like you got a liking for the law.
It looks like you're not very smart.
What do you mean?
You can't go around shooting at government men like you do at town marshals. If you'd killed that man, you'd have the whole force in Santa Fe down here on your neck before morning.
Yeah? Maybe you're right. Why should that bother you?
That, my friend, comes under the heading of my business.
Yeah?
Yeah. Come on, Doc. I'll get you that $5.
Oh, you will?
Yeah, that's a nice looking watch you got there, Doc. Where'd you get it?
Well, sir, I'll tell you, namely, that was a present to me from the medicine school where I graduated.
What, huh?
Yeah.
Well, that's funny. It says CR on the fob.
Ah, yes, dear old CR.
Hey, wait a minute. How do you spell Rufus Tate?
Why, that must have been a slight mistake of the engraver.
Yeah, I guess it was. He must have made a slight mistake on the inside, too. Charles Roth from John Gardner. Are you sure you didn't walk into Blake's room and pick this up by accident?
No. It wasn't Blake's room.
It wasn't, huh?
No. Listen, neighbor, let's just drop the whole transaction.
And you admit you stole it?
Mr. Cassidy, in a lifetime of honest endeavor, I have never so much as stolen a common pin. I might have, in a spirit or a moment of absent-mindedness, picked up something to admire it.
Oh, put it. Cut it out, Doc. Now, if you don't tell the truth, you're going to get us into a lot of trouble.
It will? Oh, well, I remember now, brother. Yes. You see, I'd gone into Ma Burton's room to get a bath towel. And on the bureau there is a little box like that.
Wait a minute. A bath towel in a little box?
Did I say bath towel? A comb. Yes, it was a comb. Well, in this box was a watch. And the watch was, there it is.
Well, you forget about it. I'll put it back and nobody will know anything about it.
You will.
Ah, thanks. And do I still get the $5? Oh, well, thank you. Beat me in.
And Cassidy won't tell me his plans until I tell him I'm sitting in on the deal.
He's pretty smart, all right.
And he's pretty quick on the trigger, too.
We could use a man like that. Tell him we're in with him.
Don't you think we have enough men on the inn now, Ma?
And he might be very valuable to us. It'll be handy having a man with a prison record in town, in case we want to put the blame on anyone. There he is now. You can talk to him in here.
Oh, Mr. Cassidy. Mr. Blake was looking for you a little while ago.
That's so? Where is he?
In his room, I think. I'll see.
Who is it?
Mr. Blake, Mr. Cassidy's here.
Would you mind coming in a minute, Cassidy? Flint's told me about the deal, and we've decided to cut in with you. That is, if your idea works.
Oh, it'll work all right.
Sit down and tell us about it. Where is the silver hidden?
It's under the floor in Gardner's office.
Well, then all that we have to do is ride out there tonight and grab it.
Yeah? Have all Gardner's miners, the fightin' men in this part of the country, on your neck? That's doing it the hard way. Sit down. Now, my idea is this. Tomorrow being Sunday, all the men from the mine will be in town, except Gardner and a watchman. And the watchman is my man.
Go on. We're listening.
The silver will be out in the open when you get there. All you have to do is load it up and bring it into town. We can hide it here in the house someplace.
How could we do that without Ma knowing?
Yes, don't kid ourselves, Blake. Come in, Ma. I thought so long as you was in on this, you might as well come in here and hear the rest of it.
How did you know I was in on this deal?
Oh, I had a hunch that whoever's the brains of this outfit would be the last person in the world anybody'd suspect. And my hunch was right. You're as smart as they make them, Ma.
You know too much for your own good.
Oh, no. Just enough to get my half of the silver. Why don't you put that thing down and let's talk business?
Why should I trust you? For all I know, you might have some other reason for spying on me.
Well, if I did have, I certainly wouldn't have tipped my mitt, would I?
Well, it looks like you've got what it takes. Maybe we'll be able to go places together.
I thought you'd see things my way. Now, the fewer in on this deal, the better. I'll ride out ahead of you in the morning. When you get there, Gardner will be blindfolded and tied up. You'll never know there's anybody else in on the deal.
Well, it's all right up to there. But you'll need a dozen pack burros to bring in $15,000 worth of silver.
Oh, no. That's where Ma comes in. You'll come out with a buckboard and bring in a load of vegetable.
Vegetable? Yes, it'll work.
I think so.
What are you doing out here?
What are you doing here?
Just a little detecting on my own.
Why don't you learn to use your head, Lucky? You know, that was bad business this morning.
Maybe it was, but I evened that up.
You didn't start anything else, did you?
No, I just wanted to prove to you I could do a few things on my own. You know, I followed Tex out to his place. That's where his gang hangs out.
Is that so?
Yeah, we get some men, we'd go out there and round them up.
Not yet. I just come from the Gardner mine. I've got a job to do up there the first thing in the morning.
What time do we leave?
We don't. I've got to play a lone hand on this. Now give me a chance to get back into town before you come in.
Hey! I've been looking all over for you.
Yeah, well, I'm looking for that dude. I'm gonna get him for pulling a gun on me.
You'll do nothing of the kind.
Why won't I?
Because he's pulling a job with us today.
You mean the mine?
Yeah, but not so loud. You get out to your ranch and wait for us there. And cut out that drinking, or we'll have more to deal with.
Told you I'd have her ready for you by Sunday morning, folks, and there she is, as good as new.
Gee, that's a swell job, mister. Say, Axel, harness her up and drive over at the boarding house, and we'll load that stuff back in.
Yeah, sir?
Hey, Axel, that blacksmith looks mighty healthy, don't he?
does, don't he?
Yeah. Maybe he's been nipping at our Zerbo.
Reckon?
I don't know. You better take a look and see if any of it's missing.
Spectrometer.
Yeah. It's a nice job.
Everything's working out all right so far, Cassidy. Gardner's men are all in town.
Yep. Working just like I figured. Oh, Ma's all set to go. You and Blake can meet her on the road.
Tex has gone out to the ranch to wait for us.
That's fine. I'm heading for the mine now.
Well, I'll pick up Blake and circle around to meet Ma.
All right.
Where are you going?
Oh, just out for a ride.
With whom? Flint?
Well, why not?
A man who's trying to go straight can't afford to be mixed up with anybody like him.
Just what are you getting at?
I know all about you, Bill. The walls in my room are like tissue paper. I couldn't help overhearing everything you told Ma the first night you were here. But I don't hold that against you, if you are trying to go straight. Please don't get mixed up with anybody like him. It'll mean a longer sentence next time if you're caught.
Now, listen, Paula. I've asked you to mind your own business. Now I'm telling you to.
What's the matter with you and Bill, Paula?
Well, I'm afraid he's going to get in trouble again.
What kind of trouble?
I don't know, but we've got to stop him before he does. And I think I know the way to do it. Paula! Marshal, can I speak with you a moment?
Why, sure.
In your office?
Oh, you bet you can. Come right in.
Paula! Look, Cassidy saved your life yesterday when that trouble started in the saloon. You owe him a great favor.
Well, I'm mighty grateful for him, miss.
Grateful enough to give him a break?
Well, of course.
Even though you found out he was an ex-convict?
Well, I wouldn't hold that against him. Providing he didn't try to pull a job in my district.
Well, for his sake, we've got to stop him before he does. Why, Paula, you don't know what you're saying. Yes, I do.
You mean to say this here Cassidy's going to pull something crooked again?
I'm afraid that's exactly what's going to happen.
Now, you just put your mind right at rest. Anytime Hoppy pulls anything crooked, it's on the side of the law. Not against it.
Hoppy?
Yeah. Hopalong Cassidy.
Oh, I just knew there couldn't be anything wrong with Mr. Cassidy.
I've been 17 kinds of a fool, even thinking there was anything wrong with him.
Yes, I've been a bit of a fool myself. Come along, Paula. Honey, you mind taking a little look around the house while I'm gone? I've got to drive out and bring back a load of vegetables.
Well, of course, Ma.
We've been double-crossed. Cassidy's the United States Marshal.
How did you find out?
Never mind, Flint. You stay with me. Blake, you get Tex and the rest of the boys to meet us here as soon as they can.
What's your next move, Ma?
You, Flint, and I will go to the mine office just as Cassidy told us to. Tex and the boys will circle around, come in from behind, and cover the place. Now, get moving.
Here they come. Silver in their possession, you'll have enough for a conviction.
I still can't make myself believe that Ma Burton's the head of that gang.
It'd be hard to make anybody believe that. What do we do with that hanger? There it is. Make it look more realistic.
I've waited a long time for this, eh?
Hey, get that gun put out of sight there till I get him covered. Your silver's all ready for you, Ma.
Well, let's get it loaded. Load in the wagon. Put him up, Mr. Marshal Hopalong Cassidy. Take his gun. Tie him up. Boys. Well, Cassidy, I'm sorry. It was either you or me.
I took a chance and lost. But I'm not complaining.
You're a game guy. And a smart one. But you weren't smart enough. And my luck still held.
It won't always hold, Ma.
Well, if it doesn't, I won't do no more complaining than you.
to those costumes so I can finish straightening up around here.
Yes, sir.
We'll hide the silver in the house until the hunt dies down. Then I'll take a little trip to Santa Fe.
It was a lucky thing for you, Ma, that you found out that Cassidy was a marshal before we went after the silver.
It may have been lucky for us, but it was mighty unlucky for Cassidy.
Get in, boys. What are you doing back here, Axel?
Oh, I was just taking these costumes out to Miss Paula in the wagon.
I suppose you've just heard what was said, Miss Paula. What's happened to Bill? We can't afford to take any chances now.
All right, get back in there. Hold on, get in there, you.
Come on. What do you think you're hiring around?
I'll ride in here and keep him quiet till we get out of town. All right, get up there in the wagon. I'll drive out of town.
Gasher, my friend, you are faced with the greatest opportunity that a man ever had. You realize, neighbor, that for $250, you can buy a quarter interest in this business.
Your men to stand by. As soon as I take care of things in here, we'll leave for Texas Hangout.
I'll go with you, Hoppy.
You keep your eye on that front door. That silver down. Get him up.
My luck didn't hold out after all.
Ma, I wish it had been anybody else but you.
I'm not complaining. I took my chances too, and I lost.
Come on.
What are you going to do with this, Cassidy?
Just hold you here until the judge comes from Santa Fe to try you.
What's that, Cassidy?
That you was a man for about 5 minutes.
Oh, no. No, thanks. I'll take the jail.
Keep your eye on them cells till I get back.
All right.
You better come with me. We got some work to do.
There's no sign of Tex or Blake at the saloon.
Well, then we'll head for Texas place. John, get your men. Come on.
Mr. Blake, you know that for a very small amount of money, you can buy a quarter interest in this business, and that I...
We'll drive to my ranch. We can hide the wagon there. Something's gone wrong.
Well, I guess that's that, Hoppy.
No, this job's not finished till we get Tex and Blake. We'll head back into town and see if we can pick up a trail. Hey, that looks like Tex and Blake on that wagon seat. John, you and your men herd these prisoners back into town.
Put up those horses, Tex. We can lose them as soon as we get to the border. Hi-ya!
Lucky. You all right, Paula?
I'm all right now, Bill.
Say, listen, practically every bottle of Zerbo is busted.
I'm glad you said that, neighbor. Now, for very little money, I'll sell you my quarter interest in this thriving business.
Keep our eye on that pop of yours, Topper. You're liable to wake up some morning and find yourself with a new stepmama.